Good morning, everyone. Welcome to a brand new edition of Art Speak TV and Radio here on Westfield Community Programming Channel 15, 89.5 FM WSKB, and our media partners at Agawam Media and Southwick Community Programming. I'm your host, Mark Auerbach, and we're beginning this hour with Marsha Harbison and John Thomas, two of the musicians from MOSO, the musicians of the Springfield Symphony Orchestra. And Marsha is a violinist, John is a baritone, and they and two other colleagues are putting together MOSO's Holiday Musicale, which performs this Sunday afternoon at 4 o'clock at the First Church on Long Meadow Street in Long Meadow. It's a mix of classics and Broadway and popular music and some of those holiday songs that you're going to want to sing along with. And I was chatting with Marsha the other day, and she's putting together a little play. She and John are putting together a little playbook of some of the lyrics of some of the sing-along songs. So you won't have to, you have no excuse to say, but I can't sing along, I don't know the words, because those words will be handed out to you. Marsha, it's good to see you, and John, nice to see you too.
Thank you.
So, Marsha, tell us a little bit about this particular program.
Well, I thought it would be fun to include Boris Kogan, our cellist, and his wife Sophie on piano, and John Thomas singing. And so, since it's right before the holidays, I thought it would be fun to do kind of short pieces to kind of keep everyone awake and clapping, and have a nice mix of classical and a few Broadway tunes and contemporary music and female composers and holiday sing-along at the end.
Give us two or three of the songs or pieces of music that you're doing that people might know or not know.
Well, we're starting with a Bach aria that John is singing in from a Bach cantata, and we're doing a Beethoven piano trio, a last movement, and it's based on a song that has kind of funny words that say, "For before I begin to work, I first have to eat." And then I'm doing two short pieces. Well, we're doing a wonderful slow movement of a Babajanian piano trio. He was a wonderful Armenian composer. It's very moving. And then I'm doing two short pieces by female composers, Lily Boulanger and Amy Beach. And then we're doing the Elgar Salute d'Amour and the A Piazzolla Tango, excuse me. And then Boris and Sophie are doing a Tchaikovsky Song Without Words for cello and piano. I'm doing a little short Fritz Kreisler encore kind of piece because it was one of my dad's favorites. And then we're doing an excerpt from John Harbison's Gatsby opera. It's called I'm Dreaming of You that John is going to sing with us. And a Broadway tune that is from this musical, 1776, called He Plays the Violin. But we're changing it to She Plays the Violin.
That's okay, you know, Marsha, because 1776 is on Broadway right now.
Yeah.
It's been revived and it's been reconfigured. It's an all-female cast. So we're keeping, we're up to date here with that change.
Yeah, that's very exciting. We're totally contemporary. Yeah, and then we're ending with the holiday sing-along. We're doing Deck the Halls, Jingle Bells, and Let It Snow.
And this all takes place at 4 o'clock at the First Church in Long Meadow. One of the things people have asked me, the MOSO coffee from Monsoon Roastery is going to be available along with MOSO t-shirts, so you can enjoy a concert and pick up some stocking gifts while you're there all at the same time. John, this is your first performance with MOSO. How did you get involved in singing?
Oh, my. It started back in church, the whole choir and singing in the choir. And we had actually sang a mixture of classical pieces. So we had to memorize Hallelujah Chorus and things like that, as well as singing a lot of gospel. And then it was discovered that I had a voice that people wanted to listen to. And that sort of started my path. It's actually not quite my first time with MOSO. I have performed with the Springfield Symphony Orchestra as a soloist a couple of times, and then once as a narrator for Magic Flute. And then having the privilege of being nearby Marsha has been great because we've had an opportunity to do several Bach arias that are written for baritone and with a violin obbligato to it. So this is one of several that Bach wrote. So that's sort of my involvement in a quick nutshell.
Did you train as a singer in the classical repertoire, or did you sort of fall into it?
Oh, actually, that's a great question. So I started as a classical oboist and was in many different orchestras, you know, sort of growing up as an oboist, all state and regionals, all in the New Jersey area, and then made the switch over from oboist to singer, mainly because I got offered a deal to get free lessons if I would perform opera arias in a sort of a evening opera group there. So I got the free lessons and then got hit with, here, we want you to memorize the 30 pages of Turandot, which we're going to have you perform in about 4 weeks' time in Italian. So that's where I got my began my vocal training. And then just locally, I've gotten vocal coaching and studying with Karen Smith Emerson, who is at Smith College. And it's essentially sort of expanded from there. So I've really more morphed over to just really a singer. And I do some performing in oboe, but not much lately. And singing is sort of taking over that element.
When was the point in, as you were starting out, when you said, what point in your musical career did you say, I got to do this? This is, I've got the calling and I've got to do this and I've got to be a singer.
Oh, that's a great question. So I switched over around college. And what happened was I joined a small singing group where we would travel to college campuses all throughout New England. So UMass and a whole bunch of others. It was this Christian singing group. We would travel every weekend and sing and perform. And it was just maybe five or six of us singers. But it sort of started me down this path where people started asking, would I sing in their wedding? Would I sing at the funerals? And after several years of doing that, and then this offer to get some free lessons, I sort of discovered that you actually can teach someone how to sing, and you can teach them how to sing better. And so once I started studying, that teacher was able to add about five notes to the top of my range to sort of introduce me to concepts like singing should never hurt, and get me to be able to roll my R's, which I can't do in speaking, but I can do it when I sing. And so she sort of helped me move down that pathway. And then since then, you know, there have been numerous opportunities throughout the Pioneer Valley and beyond to sing with different ensembles and to sort of expand my I don't know, footprint, I guess, musical footprint, as it were.
And being a classically trained singer opens doors to you. I mean, you could be doing, as you said, you've done opera like Turandot, or you've done choral music or gospel or this or that. Is there a particular genre that you like to sing more than others?
Ooh, that is a really hard one. As you know, Mark, I just finished a Broadway concert. We do a Broadway benefit, the benefits Open Pantry. We just did that about 3 weeks ago. We do it every fall. It was hugely successful. I'm one of six singers and I organized it. We were able to raise over $16,000 for that one concert for Open Pantry. So I do love singing Broadway, and just spent some time in New York this week to see a couple of new shows. And
you've got to tell me what you saw.
Oh, so we saw A Strange Loop, which, as you know, won the Pulitzer Prize and the Tony for Best Musical. It is really worth seeing. It addresses issues that needed to be discussed and need to be discussed and exposed within the gay community and outside of the gay community. And we saw Take Me Out, which was our one exception. That's a play starring Jesse Tyler Ferguson from Modern Family that many people know. And that's also a gay-themed play. But this is our second foray to Broadway this year, and we're going one more time in a couple of weeks to probably go see Funny Girl again, this time with Lea Michele.
Yeah, and my program last week and the week before taping, I went in to see Funny Girl with Beanie Feldstein. I want to go back and see it with Lea Michele. But exactly. I'm going next week to see Some Like It Hot, which is in previews right now, which I just can't wait to see.
Oh, very cool. Very cool. So yeah, to answer your question, I mean, I love Broadway. I love sort of the Cole Porter era kind of music. I think my voice is sort of suited for that. I love gospel, and it's rare to find opportunities to do much of that in this area, but it still is a love of mine. And then oratorios are probably my strong suit and what I love best. And so I'll be doing, I'll be the soloist for the Messiah Sing in Northampton coming up in a couple of weeks at St. John's Church, I believe, in Northampton, Route 9. But I love oratorio from Elijah to Messiah to you name it.
And Marcia, you play with Mosso, you play with the Springfield Symphony, you do chamber work. What kind of music do you like to perform the most?
Probably romantic pieces. I really, in the orchestra, I love the really big pieces that have lots of trumpet and trombones and very exciting pieces. And in chamber music, I guess my favorite composer is Brahms. I just love Brahms. I love all different types of music. It's fun to have a mix.
Yeah, but you like the romantic period. Do you like playing contemporary things, or do you just like playing at this point?
I think it's very important to do contemporary work, and I've really pushed that for the symphony. Maybe 3 years ago, I got them to perform 5 female composers, American female composers that are still alive, and I think it's very crucial that we still do contemporary pieces.
And I don't think orchestras do them enough. And I'm glad to see that Mosso has done some and Springfield Symphony has done some. I mean, there are some really talented composers out there that need to be nurtured, and we need to hear their music. Although at the same token, you want to hear the great masterworks, you know, like the Bach, Beethoven, and Brahms performed by a full orchestra, or going to a concert like this one on December 11th and hearing some great chamber music in a church that just, First Church is just such a great place to hear music.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's very nice acoustics, yeah.
Yeah, it's a great space. I've been singing there for, 20 plus years. I'm the baritone soloist there at First Church, and it just feels comfortable. It is, it has great acoustics, as Marcia said. And so, you know, without a mic, you can make your your lyrics really distinctive and distinguished. You know, there is a story behind the, she plays the violin, and it is coincidental now that it is on revival in Broadway. I've always loved the song, but it wasn't written for a guy, it's written for a woman. And I've always had Marcia there, who has always been willing to perform with me. And so we said, it made sense to just go ahead with making it, she plays the violin, and, you know, and I'll just change the pronoun. And so I get to do a song that I love, and I get to do it with someone who is an amazing musician. And it is not an easy violin part by any stretch. I wouldn't even consider it Broadway easy. It's really difficult and fast.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it's an amazing, you know, within the framework of the musical in which it was done, it's the one song that really stands out. It's just a really good song that you can take out of 1776. It was actually sung by Martha Jefferson, who was trying to explain to Benjamin Franklin why she's with Thomas Jefferson. And you can take it out of the show, and it holds its own. Mm-hmm. Most of the other songs in that musical don't make sense if they're not part of the show.
Right.
Yeah. So now that you can, now that you can gender bend in a particular song, the two of you can come up with a lot of songs that you've always wanted to do that weren't written for you.
Yeah, it's something I've been somewhat passionate about. So I have done that with other, particularly with Broadway numbers, where it gets you to, it reframes the song and it gets you to think about it in a different light. And I always like any kind of work of art where it takes something that we think we know and it makes us rethink it. You know, the classic one perhaps at Broadway now is Wicked, where, you know, we thought we knew the story about Dorothy and the Wizard of Oz, and then we see it through the eyes of the two witches, and then we realize, wow, it's a very different perspective, and we're not quite on Dorothy's side as much after we've seen something like Wicked. And so I've done that with other other pieces where, you know, having a guy sing it or a man sing it, or in my case where I'm a gay man and I'm singing about a crush on a boy that's in a particular song, it makes you look at it differently.
For sure. We're going to take a quick break to acknowledge our underwriters. Before we do, Mosso's Holiday Musicale is Sunday at 4 o'clock at the First Church in Longmeadow, and you can get tickets at the door, or you could get them in advance at SpringfieldSymphonyMusicians.com. We're chatting with John Thomas and Marcia Harbison. Peter Coles is our chief engineer, and we'll return after these announcements, so don't go away.
Support for community radio on WSKB provided by Westfield Electroplating. Employing over 140 skilled platers, painters, and technicians, Westfield Electroplating was founded in 1946 and was the first company in the country to achieve National Aerospace and Defense Contractor Program accreditation, proudly maintaining that status for over a decade. Westfield Electroplating provides over 50 quality finishes to meet your corrosion, cosmetic, or performance needs. On the web at www.westfieldplating.com or 413-568-3716. Westfield Electroplating, putting the finishing touches on technology.
Saturdays were made for polka. Tune in to the Polka Jammer Network starting at 6 a.m. and Polka Hall of Famer Billy Bellina, Breakfast at BB at 8:30.
Community Radio,
89.5 WSKB.
Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB Westfield.
Welcome back to Art Speed, everyone. I'm your host, Mark Auerbach. Peter Coles is our chief engineer. If you've missed a part of today's program or you want to watch it again, share it with friends, it's archived on WSKB Community Radio's YouTube page, where if you go to the YouTube page, you can find all of the ArtSpeak programs we've done this year, along with the other programs that make Westfield Community Programming and 89.5 FM WSKB part of your listening and viewing habits. Things from Wow, It's Tuesday to On the Mark to the Athenaeum Spotlight. They're all archived there. So sometimes I go back and catch a show that I haven't seen or a show that I want to watch again. And in prepping for today's show, Marcia Harbison has been on this program multiple times in her role both at the Springfield Symphony with Mosso, and she's a violinist with Mosso, and John Thomas is the baritone who sings at the First Church in Longmeadow. He's joining Mosso for this concert called A Holiday Musicale, Sunday, December 11th at 4 o'clock at the First Church in Longmeadow. And it's great to have both of you here on Arts Beat today. As you recap the year in that comes to the end in just a couple of weeks, what was your musical high point of the year, Marcia?
Oh, my gosh. Wow, that's a tough question. Well, it was always very exciting to play orchestra music and chamber music. And I think Mosso has been very successful with doing both. We were lucky enough to get Symphony Hall for free from the mayor and do some symphony concerts and Sondheim concert in the summer when the symphony wasn't planning on doing anything. And I did one of the Athenaeum concerts last year for Mosso Chamber Music. And so those were nice highlights. Oh, and then this fall, we had two female conductors with the symphony, which was a first for the symphony and very exciting for all of us.
Definitely. And just for those of you listening, we've announced it on programming before, but MOSO is returning to Westfield starting early in 2023 with a 3-concert chamber music series at the Westfield Athenaeum. And you can get details on that at the Westfield Athenaeum's website, which is westaft.org. John, what's the musical high point for you this year?
Oh, yeah. Saw that coming. I think it would have to be what just happened several weeks ago with the Broadway benefit that we gave for Open Pantry. The performances themselves, I'm just in awe of my fellow musicians. We have amazing pianists, accompanists, Larry Picard and Larry Chappell and Grant Moss. We added in a drummer with the understanding that we wanted a musician drummer, not just someone who wanted to bang on things and have everyone look at them. And he was very sensitive and did an amazing job. And I got a chance to sing quite a range of material from things from The Music Man, which I'd seen earlier this year on Broadway with Hugh Jackman. And so again, I sort of switched genders and sang Till There Was You, which is normally sung by a woman, but of course it applies because it just has to do with love. And went on to sing something by Andrew Lloyd Webber, Aspects of Love, Love Changes Everything. And then finally, I've avoided singing this for a long time, but then decided this year to sing The Impossible Dream from Man of La Mancha as a close to the concert before our final number. So that was a highlight for me. And even singing The Impossible Dream was a highlight. It is a very moving piece it's well written. So
you're going to do the Broadway concert again next November. Is that an annual thing, right?
Yes, it is an annual thing. And it's always the Saturday afternoon before Thanksgiving at 4:00 at First Church.
Yeah. So do you have any songs in mind that you're planning to do next year?
Oh, probably several hundred. We have to always narrow it down. So we start making our list now. And then at the beginning of the summer, we put them together and start voting on songs because we have to take our 100 or 200 numbers and get it down to about 20 or 30 of them. So.
Yeah, but that's got to be a fun chore. I think that would be kind of exciting, especially for people that like Broadway.
Yeah, yes. And we try our best to, educate as well as give people numbers that they know, but also introduce them to ones that are a little known or came from productions that didn't do particularly well, but that song survived and is worth hearing.
I noticed that because you had sent me the chart list for that concert, and it wasn't top 40 Broadway. I mean, there were a couple of songs everybody would know, but you really went through and picked out some interesting pieces of music.
Right. And I'm not sure everyone knows 1776 for that matter. So, to hear, he plays the violin, she plays the violin. Like you said, I think people will walk away from the musicale humming that tune. It's very catchy and it's a good one.
I sort of think people do know 1776 because oddly enough, the movie shows on TV, the movie version was really a filmed of the original Broadway cast by and large, but it shows on television just about every year around 4th of July.
Yeah, true.
Yeah, and all of that. Marcia, what's on your calendar after this concert?
Well, actually, even before this, I'm playing a couple of numbers with the Wilbraham Men's chorus or community chorus. It's a combination of the Men's Glee Club and female singers. And so Boris and I are playing a few numbers on that coming up. And then I guess mostly symphony concerts, yeah.
I mean, because your schedule, your schedule is so busy, although the symphony has not come back to its full, they used to do at least 10 concerts a year, and they're only doing 8 right now, but you seem to fill in the blanks with MOSO and a whole bunch of other things.
Right, yeah, and and I'm playing in church a few times with John and the chorus, so, or the choir. I was going to ask John, are you doing the Boar's Head Festival again?
Yes, I am. So Mark may not know this. So I've been one of the three kings of the Boar's Head Festival for the last 27 years. I guess I'm now the senior king. So that'll be happening 10th day after Christmas. So it'll be at Trinity Church, Trinity Methodist in January, mid-January. So I will be appearing there with that cast of about 200 people or whatever, all in costume. And it's quite a spectacular thing to see. It's very hard to describe it, but once you've seen it once, you know, it's something you'd want to go back to again. So I have that coming up. And then before that, as I mentioned, I'll be a soloist in Northampton for their Messiah Sing on the Sunday before Christmas.
And don't people at the Messiah Sing, don't they get to sing along?
Yes. Yeah. So when you walk in, they will hand you a score, which hopefully you'll want to open up and join in. And then everyone gets a chance to sing in the choruses. And then for the solo parts, then we have four soloists who will do those sections, well, with a sort of volunteer orchestra. So if you're an instrumentalist, you're welcome to come and join in the orchestra and play.
So, John, when you're driving back to and forth to all these gigs, what kind of music plays in your car?
Really good. There are really only two kinds of stations I listen to, for the most part. I listen to the Broadway station, of course, and I listen to classical music, because my love for it isn't just limited to the singing part of the classical genre, but, you know, I just love living the symphonies. You know, I love Brahms, and, you know, I've played a lot of the symphonies that I was very fortunate to be in a rather impressive orchestra in my high school years. And so, and I've had a lot of exposure to symphonic work. So if it has an oboe in it, or if it's some kind of a piece that features an oboe, then I would be there listening to it.
And what about you, Marcia? When you're driving around town, what's on the playlist?
Mostly WFCR, or else on a long trip, we might tune into some kind of podcast. Yeah.
Okay. Well, we're just about out of time, but let's remind everybody that Mosso's Holiday Musicale will be Sunday afternoon, December 11th, 4:00 at the First Church of Christ on Long Meadow Street on the Green in Long Meadow. There's plenty of parking around it, and you get to hear John Thomas sing and Marcia Harbison play the violin, and two other musicians, a cellist and a pianist, are joining the company. And it's a great hour of music to kind of relax to in between all the hecticness of this holiday season. So thank you. Oh, and tickets for that are available at the door or SpringfieldSymphonyMusicians.com, which is the MOSO website. I want to thank both of you for being here today, baritone John Thomas, violinist Marcia Harbison, and I can't wait to see you guys on Sunday afternoon.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, take care. We're going to take a break to acknowledge our underwriters, and we'll be back with more Arts Beat. Peter Coles is our chief engineer today.
Underwriting for the community programming of WSKB is provided by the Boys and Girls Club of Greater Westfield, serving the youth of the Whip City and surrounding communities since 1969. For more information on the Great Futures Club for ages 3 to 5, happening weekdays, and the Club Teen Center for ages 11 and older, weekdays from 6:30 till 8 p.m., go online at bcgwestfield.org or visit the club at 28 West Silver Street. The Boys and Girls Club of Greater Westfield. Great futures start here.
This is Ken Stomsky from Ken's Den on WCPC 15 and 89.5 FM, Tuesdays 8 to 10.
Community Radio,
89.5 WSKB.
Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 and 89.5 FM, WSKB Westfield.
Welcome back to Arts Beat, everyone. I'm your host, Mark Auerbach. Our guest this half hour is the singer and actor Rashidra Scott. She is currently starring in the world premiere of a musical called Christmas in Connecticut, which runs at Goodspeed Musicals through December 30th. Now, if you attend Goodspeed on a regular basis, maybe you saw her electrifying performance as Reno Sweeney in Anything Goes. And I was absolutely mesmerized because she did a performance on the hottest night of the summer of 2020 called Ambassador of Love. It was the story of Pearl Bailey, and I was totally mesmerized by that because I had seen Pearl Bailey as a child. My mother took me to see Hello, Dolly, and I was mesmerized by that performance. And so I started, as a kid, listening to Pearl Bailey, and she was on television all the time. But that was sort of the end of it. And then Rashida Scott came and did this hour-plus concert of the songs that Pearl Bailey did. And though you may have thought of Pearl Bailey as a Broadway star or a TV or movie star, she was also a major humanitarian and was known as the Ambassador of Love. And Rashida Scott, if I could have given out a Tony Award for all the shows that I reviewed that summer, you had it for that. So welcome to Art Speak.
Thank you for having me.
I know this is a nice return for you to Christmas in Connecticut and Goodspeed, but in the interim, you just finished a run in the revival of Stephen Sondheim's musical Company, and you've got a whole bunch of other Broadway credits before. Before we talk about Christmas in Connecticut, doing the revival of Sondheim's Company, I believe it was the last show he saw on Broadway before he passed away. It opened just around then. Did you get a chance to work with him at all or meet him?
No, sadly. I mean, he came into the room. He came into rehearsals. The first time that he came into rehearsals in what I like to call the before times, pre-COVID, he was initially scheduled to come in while me and my scene partner, Greg Hildreth, were working on our scene. And darn it, he came like 20 minutes early, so he didn't see our scene. We were very nervous about it, so we were fine with that. He did come again. I think he saw one of our final run-throughs, if not the final run-through, in the rehearsal space coming back from COVID. And Matt Doyle, I think somebody would always say that if you wanted to get Sondheim to cry, just get him talking about any of his collaborators. So we had that moment where he watched our last run through and he started talking about George Firth and how much he wished that George had been around still to watch our revival and how proud he was of it and happy he was of the work and what we were presenting. So I was around him. He did come to our first preview, but it was post show, and I'm that person where if someone is kind of overwhelmed by a lot of people, I just give them space. So I came out of the pass door and about 10 people, he was holding court with about 10 people. And I passed by just thinking, oh, I'll talk to him on opening night. And that did not happen. So I was in his presence, but I did not actually get a chance to speak with him one-on-one. One of the biggest regrets, I think, of my career.
But it must have been an awesome credit to have having done Company in this revised version and having his approval and having him see if it's probably the last production he ever saw and that you were a part of that.
Yeah, that as much as not meeting him one-on-one is a big regret, being a part of that and having that is probably one of the greatest highlights of my career, because never in my life did I think I would be doing Sondheim with Sondheim in the room.
It's so amazing to me. I mean, your career has spanned Broadway productions of Hair and Avenue Q, Sister Act, Beautiful, Ain't Too Proud, and Company. But now you're working on a brand new show called Christmas in Connecticut. You have to tell us about that. And is this the first time that you've created a role from first rehearsal?
No. This is me trying to think back. This is my first time creating a principal role from scratch. Sister Act was a new musical as far as I was concerned. We, once it transferred from the West End, we had a whole new book, a whole new director. So it was, while there was the songs were familiar for anyone who had seen the stage production, it was, I believe, pretty much a completely revised and different show from what had been presented on the West End. So I got a chance to create my ensemble character from scratch for that. taking over the Hair Revival cast, we essentially created our own characters with who we were in the, within the tribe. But it's definitely my first time that I can remember creating a principal named character from scratch. And especially with this short of a rehearsal period. Normally with new productions, you have at least a 6 to 8 week rehearsal process to kind of give yourself time to revise the book and figure out different lines. And, you know, we come in with new pages. We would come in with new pages daily and just stacks of new pages and new lyrics and cut songs and new blocking and how that all at one little change kind of is a domino effect to so many other things. So it's also definitely my first time creating a principal role from scratch with such a truncated rehearsal process. It's been fast and furious, but also a lot of fun with this ridiculous group of people that we've had in the room.
So I don't know much about the creators of the musical, but it's based on a movie of the same title, yes, which Barbara Stanwyck, I think, was in.
Yes.
And all that stuff. Yes. Give us a little synopsis of Christmas in Connecticut.
Oh, I guess easiest said, without too many spoiler alerts, it's a raucous, as I like to say, musical of hijinks, of falsities, and trying to keep up premises and these false narratives, and just watching everything slowly fall apart on a farm in Connecticut.
And how appropriate, because it's at good speed on the Connecticut River, just about 50 miles downriver from us up here. So
yes,
you can paddle down or drive down. And good speed is such a great place to do a show.
It is. It really is. It's so special. You walk into that opera house and you just feel kind of, I feel a majesty of the history of that building and all of the people who have walked in through those doors and stepped foot on that stage. And John Ricucci, dresser extraordinaire. I love Ricucci. He was my dresser when I did Anything Goes and when I was here last summer for Ambassador of Love. He's been with the Opera House, I think he said, for about 40 years. So you walk into his office and the walls of his office, it's just a history of who's who and what's what that's been at Goodspeed and his connections to people from his experience here at Goodspeed.
Yeah, and one of the things I should mention is that when Goodspeed, during the pandemic, they did a benefit, or they had a benefit,
yes,
scheduled, and you were part of that, and they filmed it, and it ended up,
yes,
and how you were able to go up and down that grand staircase, up and down and singing, that was a milestone. That was really kind of incredible.
And you only saw the edited version, so you only saw me do it about 3 times. We were here all day doing it.
What kind of role do you play in Christmas in Connecticut? Who is your character?
My character is Gladys Higginbottom, and she is an aspiring fact checker. She's a sleuth, if you will. She loves her heroes and heroines are Nancy Drew and Miss Marple and Nora Charles and Agatha Christie and she's the one who's keeping an eye out on all of the hijinks and slowly piecing things together as things. She's the first person who really starts to see what the falsities are and how things are falling apart.
And do you have a couple of songs and dances?
I have one song, not much dancing, surprising. I'll take it.
You'll take it.
I will. It's almost, I'd like to call it a park and bark track for me, where you don't really have a lot of movement. You just get to stand and sing.
Yeah. Now, and the day that we're taping this arts beat, you're in your final previews before your press opening
yes,
next week. But
yes,
from the day that you got the script and started rehearsal to the preview performances, has the show changed a lot? Or
Oh, yeah. We've had full sections of songs that have gone away. I think definitely one, possibly two songs were learned that no longer exist. We've done some reordering of scenes. The song that I do started out as, I don't know, maybe 10 pages into Act Two, and then it was ending Act One, and then it was near the end of Act One with a few lines and another little revisal. Of a song, and now I'm opening Act Two. So we've had a lot of jigsaw puzzle pieces moving to get to where we are.
And of course, this is really what Goodspeed does so well, because if you look back at this theater's history, many shows mm-hmm. that moved to Broadway started at Goodspeed. Annie is probably the most famous, Man of La Mancha, yes. Shenandoah, a couple of years ago, Irving Berlin's Holiday Inn, Come mm-hmm. From Away, which was a big Broadway hit, went through the developmental stage at Goodspeed. So they are adept at taking brand new material and turning it into something bigger and bigger. Have they talked about a future for Christmas in Connecticut at this point?
Sure the creatives know, but as far as the cast, for us as the cast, our contractual commitment is just for here at Goodspeed. So that's not necessarily information that we would be privy to, but I'm keeping my ears open.
I bet you are. Who are the composer and lyricist? What kind of music are you singing in this? Is it kind of period piece music, or is it contemporary?
It's a little amalgam and a mashup of both. Getting some jazzy standards. You're getting some really fun things. Our lyricist Amanda and my friend Jason Howland, he's the composer and he wrote the music. It's kind of a reunion of sorts. Howland and I first met doing Beautiful, the Carole King musical on Broadway. He was our music supervisor and music director. So I've gotten a chance to do a few projects with Howland over the almost, 10 years that I've known him. And I always joke, I say, my friend knows how to write a bop. So I'm having the time of my life singing his melodies. And Amanda has the wittiest, most quippy lyrics that are like ridiculously hard to learn. But once you get it, it's like, oh yeah, it's kind of a feat and a self-competition, a little self-congratulatory at the end of every number once you spat out all those witty lyrics. And she keeps you on your toes. It's really fun.
You've done all this musical theater in your career. What was the first show you saw as a kid that made you say, I got to do this?
Oh, you know, I think the first show that I can remember that I saw when I turned to my mom and said, I'm going to be in the show, I have to figure this out, was actually after I graduated high school. And we did a family trip to Disney World and we were watching Tarzan Rocks at Animal Kingdom's Theater in the Wild. And it was just this fast paced, rocking out celebration of all of the Phil Collins music from Tarzan. And they had stunt skaters and aerialists down ropes, and there was a Jane and a Tarzan doing all this rope stunt choreography and three singers. There was a male lead singer, your female soprano, and your female alto singer, backed with a live band playing to like a time code track. And it just was so high energy. And I was 17 and I looked at my mom midway and I was like, I have to do this show. And I found the call booth after the show and asked them for information on how to find out auditions for it. And my first contract was with Disney Cruise Lines, but my second contract, I did end up doing Tarzan Rocks. I've started out in theater and performing more so as a hobby, just kind of something to do. For a while, my mom was raising me as a single mother. When she remarried my stepdad, they worked completely opposite schedules. So, you know, she would come home from a full day at work and I was bouncing off the walls because I was an only child. I had no other way to burn that energy off. And so she got me into dance classes and community theater, pretty much just to burn the energy off. And she had no idea what a monster she was creating at like 5 years old.
So you did the cruise ships for a while before you did land theater, so to speak.
Yeah. Yeah. I did one cruise line contract and then I did Tarzan Rocks in Orlando. I opened Hong Kong Disneyland. So I was in Hong Kong for about 10 months. And then I went back to Disney Cruise Lines to save money to move to New York. And I've been in the city for about 15 years now. I think August was my 15th year anniversary.
What did you, so you've been very successful on the stage because going back and looking at your credits, if you've been in New York 15 years, you've been working all 15 years in New York.
Yeah, I've only exhausted one unemployment claim in my life.
You're very lucky at that.
Yeah.
Rashida, we're going to take a quick break acknowledge our underwriters. And then when we come back from the commercial break, we're going to show you all a clip that Goodspeed has kindly sent us. It's their B-roll for Christmas in Connecticut. So if you're listening to us on radio today, you may want to go back and watch this program on YouTube at WSKB Community Radio so you can see the song and dance from Christmas in Connecticut that we're going to show you after the break. Peter Coles is our chief engineer. I'm Mark Auerbach, and we'll return in just a moment.
Underwriting for Community Radio on WSKB is brought to you in part by Rockies. Over 30 convenient locations throughout Massachusetts, Rhode Island, New Hampshire, Connecticut, and Florida. One of the nation's largest Ace dealers. Expertise and great product selection in paint, hardware, lawn and garden. That's Rockies, rock solid service since 1926. On the web at Rockies.com. Support for the community programming of WSKB is provided by the Dunkin' Donut Shops of Westfield and the Sardinia family. It's nice to know that even as the world changes, Dunkin' Coffee remains the same at 7 convenient locations throughout Westfield.
Join us every Thursday morning
from 6 until at least 7:30.
Check out the Bobby G and Company Show
right here on WSKB 89.5.
Community Radio 89.5
WSKB.
Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 at 89.5 FM WSKB Westfield.
Welcome back to Arts Meet. Peter, can we B-roll the Christmas in Connecticut tape? And there you have a sneak preview of Christmas in Connecticut at Goodspeed Musicals. It's running through December 30th, and you can get tickets and information at goodspeed.org. And while you're there, you might want to check out, Goodspeed has already announced its 2023 season, which opens with one of the most famous musicals of all times, Gypsy. And our guest this half hour is Rashida Scott, who's a member of the cast of Christmas in Connecticut. Her Broadway credits are immense. She just finished a run in the acclaimed revival of Stephen Sondheim's Company, which co-starred Patti LuPone. She's been in Ain't Too Proud. She's been in Avenue Q. She's been at Goodspeed before in Anything Goes, playing the iconic part of Reno Sweeney, which was originated by Ethel Merman. And one of my favorite performances of all time was her rendition of Pearl Bailey's music. It was done at a tent at Goodspeed. It was called Ambassador of Love. Are you going to do that show again?
Hopefully. my music director, Michael Mitchell, and I we're excited to have it kind of in our back pocket, but we're both so unbelievably busy. He especially, he's the associate MD over at MJ, the musical right now. He's also the MD at the Apollo, so they have a lengthy season. He was teaching at a university as well. And he's also married, so, you know, it has to be time for life. I did make my New York City, I guess, cabaret debut with it in the spring. We did a showing at Green Room 42. One of these days, we'll figure our schedules out to be able to do it again, because we really would like to.
from what I understand from the folks at Goodspeed, it was your idea to bring that project to fruition. What intrigued you about Pearl Bailey?
Honestly, I had a friend of mine who I did Beautiful with, Kevin Duda, randomly text me one night over the shutdown with a YouTube link to a video of Pearl Bailey performing. He and his partner said, "You have to watch this. You remind me so much of her." And honestly, before that, I embarrassingly did not really know a lot about Pearl. She wasn't really on my radar. I knew who she was. I just didn't really know a lot about her. And I watched that video and fell in love with her energy and her personality and went down a rabbit hole. And over the shutdown, Goodspeed did a series of virtual programming. And in one of them, they did a look back of some of the Goodspeed favorite shows, one of which was Anything Goes. And in that virtual program, I mentioned to Donna Lynn, which I now know, be careful what I say around her because she will hold you to it. I mentioned to her that I had had a dream of creating my own show and I just had never done it. And so February, I believe, of 21, when they were looking at what their programming was going to be, they knew they had bought the tent. She called me and said, "Hey, remember that time you said you want to do a show? So we got a tent. You want to do a 6-week show? You want to create it and write it and do it at the tent?" And I was like, "Okay." So first thing that popped in my head was, who better than Pearl Bailey? So that was how it got started. And I just spent a couple of months reading one and a half of her books. I didn't get through the second book, but I got through all of the Raw Pearl and I made my notes and picked out the team. And Goodspeed, Donna Lynn, and everyone here at Goodspeed was invaluable to helping me. We had periodic meetings so they could check on me, offer me any assistance that I needed in creating it. And we got everything up and running.
And you had so much material to work with. You had to cut things out. You couldn't have done every song.
Oh, yeah.
Every song she had ever done or anything like that.
Yeah, I think that was one of the most difficult parts of the process for me was once I started listening to and going down the audio rabbit hole of how much material she had and also trying to parse out which of her fields and which genres did I want to focus on. Anyone could do an entire show just on her theater material, just a separate show on her on-screen material. She was also in a few movies and television programs. Actually, was it 2 weeks ago? I randomly was flipping through and Carmen Jones was on and I got to watch a little snippet of her in that. Her body of work is immense. So it was really difficult trying to cut down and streamline and figure out which songs to actually focus on and do.
I just remember watching it and I was mesmerized, but there was another theater reporter who was sitting across the aisle from us who was significantly older and had seen Hello Dolly and seen some of her other. I saw Hello Dolly with Pearl Bailey, but I was a kid. I didn't know what I was seeing.
Jealous.
At the time. But he had seen other things like House of Flowers and other work that she had done over the years. And he said that not only did you capture the musicality of her music, but you captured her personality. And it was, and he said, when you think about it, you were doing this performance in a tent on a hot and muggy night on the Connecticut River with the party boats going up and down behind you on the river. But you were able to totally enrapture a crowd of people. And he said, you had the Pearl Bailey thing. So I sure hope from a personal level, you take that somewhere else and do it again.
Thank you so much. I like to say it's our shared Virginia roots that helps give, there's just something in our water in Virginia. Just, hopefully, like I said, hopefully. And I have further productions of it, I absolutely will be posting it on social media. I'm really bad at my social media unless I'm promoting something. So if you see me post something, it's because I'm doing something.
Exactly. So what's on your schedule after Goodspeed?
I can't say yet because the press release hasn't come out. I don't like to share things until the press release has come out. But I did just sign my contract 2 days ago. And so I will be doing a production. I'm going to be so muddy clear. I'm doing a production of a beloved Disney movie that is finally becoming a stage musical, in that will be performed in February and March at a regional theater in New Jersey. There we go. I'm assuming a press release will be coming out soon because we just signed contracts.
Yeah. So how many shows can you do over the course of a year? Because you're always working.
Honestly, it just depends on the length of the run of the show. It depends on if it's a regional production. Is it a Broadway show? How long am I contracted? So it kind of varies. I mean, this year will be two because most of my year was with company. Yeah, I've spent years where I've only done one show for the entire year, years at Beautiful. I've had years at Beautiful where I was able to do two shows, like when I was here with Anything Goes, because Beautiful gave me a leave of absence. I've had years where I've done six shows because, or, you know, five or six shows because they varied from a 2 month run to a few months.
Well, we have to tell people, if you want to see Rashida Scott live on stage, you have to buy tickets to Christmas in Connecticut at Goodspeed. That show only runs through December 30th, and tickets for that are available at goodspeed.org. Rashida, thanks for being here today.
Thank you, and get your tickets quickly, because as far as I know, we have a lot of shows that are either sold out or close to sold out, and we can't add shows because we gotta go.
Because you got something to do afterwards. Well, thanks for being here today. We're going to end today's program with Pearl Bailey singing from the Broadway cast recording of Hello, Dolly, So Long, Dearie. Peter Coles has been our chief engineer. Rashida Scott from Goodspeed's Christmas in Connecticut has been our guest. I'm Mark Auerbach. We'll see you next week on another Arts Beat.
Thank you.
Goodbye. Goodbye. Goodbye, 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 goodbye. Don't try and stop me, Horace, please. Wave your little hand and whisper, so long, dearie, you ain't gonna see me anymore. But when you discover that your life is dreary, don't come a-knocking at my door. Cause I'll be all dressed up and singing that song that says you dog. I told you so. Oh, wave your little hand and whisper so long, dearie, dearie. Should have said so long ago. Cash register. It's a little